Thank you very much for inviting me here to this conference. I thought it is useful, and not only for the non-Assyriologists, but also for the Assyriologists dealing with much later periods, to start with a short slide, so two slides, where we are. We are in southern Mesopotamia, called Babylonia as a landscape, in the third millennium. And I tend to call now the third millennium the early Bronze Age, because the archaeological term, or the Bronze Age, gives it a unity in cultural terms. And so the separation is at the end of the millennium, 2000 BC. This period of the third millennium, the early Bronze Age, is characterized by the urban culture, the diversification of crafts. We have a number of innovations in the history of human mankind exactly in this period. And this is why it stands out as a period to be studied. I will concentrate on two places, pre-Sargonic or early dynastic Lagash, which is the 24th century before Christ. Lagash is, with its capital Girsu, one of the many city-states, and the term city-state should not let us forget that these city-states consisted of various cities beside the capital, secondary cities. These cities were organized or were inhabited by communal organizations, I would call them, mostly named after temples, large communal organizations of various hundreds or even thousands of persons who did the agriculture, the herding, the crafts, and which allowed the diversification of crafts. The most important archive I will present here or deal with are the texts from the organization of the Lady of Lagash, the wife of the city ruler, which gives us a female perspective on Mesopotamia with about, from about 1,700 administrative documents. All documents are administrative, meaning recording the availability and the transfers of goods and services. Then I will also include in the early Bronze Age the Sargonic and dynasty and the dynasty, third dynasty of Ur. At the end of the millennium, there are so many aspects of continuity between early dynastic, pre-Sargonic, and Ur III that it makes sense to include them and to make this divide. Although there are also a lot of developments, most prominently that there under Akkad and Ur, there is now a king on top of the or above the former city governors, which are now governors of provinces and not of independent city-states anymore. Much of my talk will concentrate on the documentation from the third dynasty of Ur because of the enormous wealth of documents from this period. My paper deals with a specific office, namely the cupbearer, also translated as steward, and I also use the Sumerian term sagi as to describe this person. His close connection to the cult was already well known from the end of the early Bronze Age, the period of the third dynasty of Ur, because he appears in the documentation as the responsible person when animals from the royal herds were sent to sacrifices. Whereas later, in the old Babylonian period, such a role of the sagi in the performance of sacrifices was, at least to my knowledge, you can correct me, not known. He appeared in such a function prominently already in the early dynastic period, so we have this continuity in the early Bronze Age. Furthermore, in the small world of the city states of pre-Sargonic Lagash, the social position of the sagi can be well defined. He was a person very close to the members of the ruling family. This is no wonder, considering the primary duty of a sagi to care for the drinks and the food for his masters. This implies that the food and drinks had to be provided, selected, and of the best taste possible. The cupbearer served it and cared for the guests at the meal. When preparing this talk, everybody said to me, well, and he preserved and protected his master so that he could not be poisoned. And interestingly, this is the idea everybody has, but it's more important to have a group of well-armed guards to protect the ruler. So why don't people think about the guards? The difference is that the sagi is a person so close to the person of the ruler and not as the guards at the outside. There's much more about this office. The city ruler, his wife, or their children needed persons they trusted. And for a daily company, at every meal, at least they had to get along with them personally. This was the situational background to appreciate an absolutely exceptional seal inscription dedicated by King Ibisin to the Kapirasina Bushu, whom the king called the friend of his youth. The Sagi was considered as being so close to the family that he was even depicted within the family in the reliefs of Onansha of Lagash, where he holds a jug to indicate his office. You see him always in the back of the ruler. The cupbearer thus served the ruler, his family, or some other master, but from the pre-Sargonic to the O3 period, there's ample evidence that he brought sacrifices to the temples as well. This situation offers a perfect opportunity to review the concept of priests in Mesopotamia. A priest can be defined as a professional acting as an intermediary between human and divine sphere. That is the short definition I've given in the Real Lexicon. The definition implies that the job was in the service of religion, and here borderline cases are known too. Do we call, for example, musicians in the service of a temple priests or priestesses? Since the term used to describe their job appears outside the temple as well, therefore professions like musicians, cooks, brewers that are not restricted to the temple or other religious contexts will not be perceived as priests. In theological terms, priests are sometimes defined as being an earthly representative of a deity, which is completely impossible for the third millennium of Mesopotamia. And to define a priest as a member of a social class or a legal definition, as it's possible for the sixth century, is not possible for the third millennium, since as with almost every profession, one finds priests in different social contexts. So there's nothing like a social definition possible for the third millennium. Other aspects like cultic purity, selection, and education depended on a specific historical situation and should not be used to define priesthood. But the title alone does not necessarily indicate the job profile. In this paper, I will discuss the job profile of the cupbearer, then concentrate on his religious role, and this allows then a comparison with the professional cult priest, the guru, and then hopefully will lead to a better understanding of the interaction of the Sumerians with their temples. This investigation, in fact, forms part of a series of studies I do on the religion of the early Bronze Age in Mesopotamia. And I have to make clear, and I think it's useful to make that clear too, that I understand religion as a cultural system that as an ideal gives sense to a society. And here I follow the definitions of Emil Durkheim, the work of Mary Douglas, or the aspects of Clifford Geertz. But this is important in our field as theology. Since societies change fundamentally from the third to the first millennium, Mesopotamian religion is in fact changing constantly. And the traditions of divine characters, of cult places, or even priestly titles effectively hide these changes and often form more an obstacle than a help for the researcher. Now to the cupbearer. The job of the Sagi can be shortly described as a steward or waiter who served his master or mistress and the guests at meal. In Sumer, a meal consisted mainly of beer and bread, and occasionally fruit, vegetables, onions, fish, or meat could be added. The so-called messenger text of the O3 period, expenditures for daily meals of official guests in rest houses, demonstrate that the meal there included oil for anointing as well. Similarly, every person participating at the annual festival of Bao in pre-Sargonic Gyozo received a piece of bread, a beaker of beer, vegetables and fish, and he or she was anointed as well. Archival documents concerning the Sagi documented his care of the vessels and dishes used for meals, and he appears as responsible for beer and food. Perhaps the best description of the job of the steward is describing the job of the god Shulshagana when introduced to his master Ningirsu. He serves his master food and drinks in the temple Eninu, including a careful hand washing. And then the high quality food makes Ningirsu to rise from his bed and to come to the meal. To clean the house, to apply hand washing, a pure hand to give water to his lord. to brew beer into precious dishes, alcoholic beverages in vessels, to let the Emma beer splash like the waters at Parsia, drink. And then when the perfect oxen, kids, sheep, bread, milk are brought from day to night, so that they let the authority, the beloved son of Enlil, the warrior of Ningirsu, rise from his sleep for the consumption probably of food and drink. For this he introduced the Lord of Splendid Hand Washing, Ninu's first son, Shulshaga, and his agency to Ningirsu. So the hand washing was the essential part of the meal. This is what I want to make clear here. It pre-Sargonic Girsu as well, the Sagi in the office of his mistress, was the one to bring the city ruler and his wife beer. He cared for travelers, and there's also texts documenting that he took over the fish brought from the fishermen. But what the steward meant for the members of the ruling family becomes most clear from the composition of the organizations of the princes and princesses. I give two examples, two texts, one from the time from Lugalanda, one from the time of the Orokagina, the two kings. First text, two princesses with a group of the same professions which we meet everywhere, the cupbearers, then maids and nurses. The term chato is unclear, but there should be something like domestics, maids that care, and one cook here, one barber there. Interestingly, in the second group, it is said that these four or five persons, two women, two cupbearers, lived within the palace. And this administrative note separates the group of cupbearers, chato women, from the other professions in the documents. Other than the translation cupbearer and the associations with banquets suggest, the cupbearers were the men who cared for the royal children, princes and princesses alike. Evidently, this implied the supply of food and drinks and bodily care, as washing and anointing, and so the cupbearer became one of the closest and most familiar persons during childhood, and that's what I think is important here. The cupbearers remained in the group of domestics also for grown-ups, as demonstrated by the lists of persons stationed permanently in the palace, that is, the Emunu's personal living in the city ruler's palace. The lady of Girsu had her organization, but she lived in the palace with the city ruler and with their children. And in the texts of their organizations, there's a group of persons, something like 30, which are in the palace. And we see all the persons that are around her to look for the interior, the hot water person. So there's some supervisors, a scribe, and a large group, again, of maids and of stewards or cupbearers. Apparently, the profession of serving was considered a male profession, since even in the latest staff, no women appeared in this job. It seems to be a feature of later periods that the staff of a queen became more and more female in Mari or in Middle and Eocene periods. Knowing the duties of a steward, their large number also indicate daily banquets in the ladies' quarters. The persons from the palace, so close to the lady, played a central role in the main religious festival that the Emunu's organization organized every year, the festival of Bau, the wife of Girsu's city god Ningirsu, and thus the divine patron of the lady. Among other guests, the wives of the most important members of the city-state, here I would use the term elite in fact, participated in this female festival. They received a donation from persons of the Emunu's. They had the ladies take milk and malt as a present. The causative formulation that the presenters made the honored guests take the food as a present, the absolutely unique designation of the food as holy, mark these presentations, and extraordinarily, the subscript notes the number of persons, the presenters, and not the amount of goods distributed. Therefore, I conclude that these texts document the distribution of the sacrifices that had been previously presented to the gods, to Bau and to her husband, Ningirsu, to distribute these goods among the most important guests. The 40 to 50 persons that presented the special food to the honored guests were first some of the highest ranking persons in Emunu's, including the chief manager in Ikgal, And secondly, and it's underlined on the slide, the lady's personnel of the palace, the cupbearers, the cooks, the envoys, or her maids and nurses. The palace personnel had no power in the sense that they directed subordinates, but they were close to the lady herself. In a distribution ritual of the sacred food, the palace personnel thus served as representatives of their mistress. She was multiplied as a person, so to say. To conclude, the cupbearers were, together with the Khartoum maids, the closest personal attendants of the ruler's wife, the princes and the princesses in early dynastic Gyrzu. As such, they could act as doubles for the mistress in a religious festival when they distributed sacred food, probably the leftovers of the sacrifices, to the most honored guests. In these instances, the cupbearer was chosen because of the close personal relationship to the royal family, a relationship that transpires also in the participation of the cupbearer among the ruling family in Oranje's reliefs or his service in confidential diplomatic missions. His role as a person close to the family, but probably also his experience in caring for his masters, made him the representative in a very special ceremony, the dressing of the ancestors in the course of a festival. At Bau's festival, the statues of deceased ladies were dressed with new clothes and adorned with jewels. There, besides the launder for some textiles, the cupbearer decorated the statues. And the line, the sequence of the steps becomes very clear from the texts. The jewels were given to the four ladies, that is, to their statues, and the subscript reads, at Bau's festivals, to the cupbearer Bau Ikgal, Sasa, the wife of Urkagina, king of Lagash, gave them the jewels. So the cupbearer executed the offering in the name of the lady. They did not only bring dedications of jewels, but also food offerings, both to the dead ancestors and to the gods. And again, there's the same series of steps. The city ruler or the lady of Gyrzu give the goods to the cupbearer who presents them. In all cases, the cupbearer executed the lady's or the city ruler's dedication of jewels or the sacrifice of food and drink to the dead ancestors or to the gods, and there was no further step behind that. So this role of the cupbearer as presenting goods to the gods is also known for the Sargonic period. One should cite in this context, or always it's cited in this context, that Sargon, king of Akkad, was, according to the legend, the cupbearer of his king. And because of bringing the sacrifices to the temple, he became the favorite of the goddess Ishtar. Now turning to the last period of the early Bronze Age, the Ur III period. Here the cultic role of the cupbearer was more often connected to the king. In documents from the royal holdings at Pusresh Dagan, the Sagi appears as the one who was allowed to execute the sacrifice of animals to the gods when the king was not personally present. Here the Sag cupbearer worked in commission for the king, who otherwise entered himself. The close link of the cupbearer to the king becomes clear in other documents from Umar, for example. It's very clear that in connection with offerings from the sacrifices from the king, we have the cupbearer, whereas the ordinary, regular regime of offerings was done without this role of the cupbearer. And we have the same in Gyrzu with a slightly different formulation. Thus, there's an impressive tradition of the cupbearer responsible to bring royal sacrifices into the temples to the gods or to the ancestors. In all cases of the documentation, we deal with additional royal or other personal gifts to the temples, not the regular regime. This allows us to put the evidence in context, be it the pre-Sargonic documentation or the Ur-3 text from Pusresh Dagan. The offerings delivered by the cupbearer were additional gifts. The constant supply was organized by the temple itself. And it's important to have the Amonas archive, because usually these our perspective then is attracted by the person of the ruler. And here the Amonas archive is important because it's the perspective of the wife of the ruling family. Secondly, whereas in the pre-Sargonic text, some other persons could appear with offerings brought to the temple as well, an animal fattener here, a barber there, in the O3 period it was exclusively the cupbearer. So the office of presenting food to the gods became more and more professional, and the steward, whose main duty was to serve his master and mistress and their guests at meal, became the only representative of the king to serve the gods. The cupbearer was a steward to serve drinks and food, and who, with hand washing and anointing, also cared for the wellness of the guests. As a professional in serving drinks and food, he could represent sacrifices to the gods as well. Although in the cult the cupbearer most often appeared as a representative of the king in the O3 period, there were also other sages active in the cult, but which are less well documented. Whereas activities of the cupbearer are well documented in pre-Sargonic Girusu, this is much less the case with the priest. So we have the cupbearer with the sacrifices. And my first idea was, in fact, when dealing with this topic, while the cupbearer fulfills the roles of the priests, where are they? Where are the priests? They are not documented in the Aemonus archive because they did their daily service there, and they are activities were not covered by this archive. There we see sometimes the main representatives of the temples, the temple lords, as I translate the term Sangha, and the singers of lamentations. There are attestations for a guru of various gods, and some appear as holders of fields, but never in the center of the archive. The guru's role as a priest constantly active in the temple appears much clearer for the O3 period. Now, the text will be presented by Piotr Steinkeller, as I have seen in my handout, so I can just point to it, because it's a really wonderful text, showing the first equipment of a new temple of divine Shulgi, with the necessary fields and animal herds for regular income, and the vessels for the cult. But he also installed the personnel, those working in the fields and gardens, herdsmen, and cook and brewer as well. Furthermore, women grinding flour and weaving clothes. The only persons active in the cult were one guru priest at the head of the personal list and three singers. The guru priests were installed in basically all the temples. He was a priest at duty with a variety of relevant tasks. He cared for the temple building, managed the dedications to the deity by placing the various precious vessels and other objects on the board of offerings. For the sacrifices, the presentation of foodstuffs in the daily cult or at festivals, he received the grain. He is once attested using oil for anointing, and he was present when an oath was sworn in front of a deity. Thus, mainly two offices placed the dedications and the sacrifices of foodstuffs in the temples. The cult priest, guru, maintained the daily cult and regular festivals, thereby using the food prepared by the temple's personnel from the yields of the sanctuary's fields, gardens, and animals. The cupbearer, Sagi, brought additional special donations from the king, the city ruler, or perhaps other masters. In practice, however, these two offices were not as separate as the translations might indicate, since the office of the priest could be performed by a cupbearer. There are two sets of evidence for this, one from Umma and one from Girsu, and possibly they actually represented two different structures of the office. So from Umma, the best example is a text, a list of persons called Gudu, and among these persons called Gudu, that means cult priests, there are various offices, and most of them related not only to the preparation, but also to the presentation of food and drinks. In Girsu, the other province, one can cite three documents, and always it's a receipt of grain by a person who is called Gudu in the document, but Sagi on his seal. Both Fabien Hubert-Vuillet and Piotr Michalowski, who have cited such instances as well, thought of a career. Their respective persons had first worked as a cupbearer before becoming a priest. In our second example, it is in fact the father of the priest who was the cupbearer. But in the third example, we have a person with both titles. He is cult priest and cupbearer in the seal. The seal is always in blue. An important clue to understand the underlying reality is in fact the first example where the cult priest is on duty. And there is more evidence for the cult priest on his term of duty. The Zagi cupbearer working as a priest thus did the service for the gods not permanently, but when he was on duty. All reference to the term of duty or prebend of Gudu priests stem from Gilsu. In the same province, artisans put perform their duty in the course of the annual festival of Nindara, and for their service they received a part of the temple's foodstuffs. Falkenstein, in his Neusumerische Gerichtsurkunden, has pointed to the fundamental difference of the Ur-III prebends compared to those of the old Babylonian and Neo-Babylonian period, since in the third millennium, these offices and their income were not a private property and thus could not be sold, exchanged, pledged, or divided. Besides that, the only prebend known from the Ur-III period is the Gudu office, that is a generally priestly service for the gods, whereas already in the old Babylonian period times, offices were divided among various functions, and in the first millennium, those preparing the food were involved as well. We will hear much more about these prebends during this conference. The proximity in the duties of the Zagi and the Gudu and the actual performance of priestly duties of cupbearers leads us to an important aspect, namely the work of priests in an early Bronze Age Mesopotamian temple. The only direct testimony thereof, of what the priest did, is a document from the Inanna Temple of Nippur, a list of duties of his temple lord, and the duties he had to perform in the month of Inanna's festival. His responsibilities included tasks as diverse as the preparation of beer, the transport of offerings to Enlil's temple, or the bathing of the divine statue. He was the expert of objects in the temples and the practices, including rituals. At smaller sanctuaries, the duties of a Gudu priest were surely comparable to this. Leaving the large annual festivals aside, undoubtedly the sacrifice can be considered the central religious practice in Mesopotamia. And by calling it central religious practice, I really mean that, and I have it at the same level as, for example, the prayer in Christianity or meditation in Eastern religions. The range of professions active in a temple, all having to do with the preparation and serving of food, the royal dedications of regular income of the temple, or the descriptions in literature, all these references point to the central role of the sacrifice. The sacrifice now can be defined as the presentation of prepared food and drink, and sometimes incense, to the gods. This practice had its secular counterpart in the service for an honored guest, and in both cases, the rank of the guest, the composition of the group of guests, the date and time, and the role of the host determined the quantity and selection of food and drinks supplied. When the meal was prepared for the guest, his or her presence was presupposed. There was no need for a theater-like staging of the divinity eating. Musicians played both at banquets in the palace and in the temple, and the performance of music marked the event as special, with the songs surely praising the respective gods or the ruler. Although there exist no sources to describe the ritual actions in the temple for our millennium, the fact that professional stewards served both in the temple and in the palace hints at a certain perfection and thus ritualization of the service. To appreciate the solemnity and dignity, one should consider as well the setting of the ritual in the temple with its magnificent architecture or the decoration with niches even in smaller sanctuaries. The social practice of serving food was deeply rooted in the society, as we have seen. The cupbearers were the most familiar servants of princes and princesses in the palace. A large group of them stayed with the lady. Their office was perhaps the most important one in life at court. Obviously, not every Sumerian had his personal cupbearer, but the profession was well known, and its special rank acknowledged, since here, ordinary people could enter the innermost circle of the ruling families. It is in this historical cultural context that the sacrifice has to be placed as the central religious practice, which the priest performed as professional butler who featured a special intimacy with his mistress and master. The comparison between a sumptuous banquet and a sacrifice in the temples pertains to details of the action as well. Food and drinks were presented in vessels, as was the water for hand washing and for libations. And I'm very grateful to Elisa Rosberger, with whom I could discuss the vessels, and I had prepared for a previous version of this talk. Lists of vessels in cultic and in secular context, and it's impossible to make a difference between two these sets of vessels used. While pointing to the similarities between banquets and sacrifices in our discussion, we must not forget the differences. The imagery of the third millennium displays an impressive difference between the figure serving the drinks or the water to wash the hands. It's on the left side here, so the one with presenting the water to wash the hands, and here the one presenting the drink. The man is clothed in banquets with people drinking and dining, but he is nude when he pours out a libation in front of a deity. After the previous discussion, we understand that the first one can be identified as a cupbearer, Sagi. The second one could be a priest, Gudo. But we are now also aware that the two job profiles were very similar and that sometimes cupbearers served as priests. Nakedness marked the priestly actor in the imagery, and because of this evidence, there's little reason to doubt that the priest actually performed his service in nudity. We approach one problem of the delimitation of the sacred space, namely the ritual purity, which implied the ritual purity of priests as well. For the third millennium, there exists no text as the old Babylonian incantation for the consecration of a Gudu priest, published by Farbers. One clue in this regard for the purity is the presence of a barber among the priests of Shara et Umma. Also in pre-Sargonic document, the barber was listed once among the persons who brought the sacrifices. Was he there to shave the one presenting the sacrifices? And did he shave the city ruler? Another clue is a list of clothes given out to the priests of Shara et Umma. And in one text, there's an absolutely unique entry where it is said that one textile, when he was purified for Ogigia, the one pouring beer, who is one of these in the context of the personal of Shara, God Shara et Umma. Regarding the purification of priests, the fact that the priestly office could be performed for a certain period comes into play. Although the editors of the incantations to purify priests called these the consecration, weihe, of a priest, be it Borg or Farbers, which suggests a permanent change of status, the observed practice of a temporarily defined priestly service indicates that the purification had to be repeated as well. In our O3 example from the Shara temple, the person pouring the beer received clean clothes. He must have been closer to the deity than other visitors of the temple. To cite just one example, at Bao's festival in pre-Sargonic years, we know of 500 persons who have gathered, and the only place where they could have done this was the large courtyard of the Ningirso temple. The participants not only received food, but were anointed as well. When you are anointed, it implies that you had washed before. Whether this happened at home, at the entrance in the sacred precinct, or in the courtyard itself, is perhaps less important than the act of washing itself. The awareness of being clean, and thus in a new and more solemn state, prepared for a festival close to the deity. The priest serving the gods in a cupbearer's way temporarily probably had to be purified regularly before they started their period of duty. At the end of this paper, let us return to the cultic role of the cupbearer. As we have seen, he brought dedications of objects as well as sacrifices of foodstuffs to the temple. He was qualified for this in two regards: as a confidant of his master or mistress, fulfilling the most intimate position at court, he could represent him or her also in front of the gods. Secondly, the performance of a sacrifice consisted of serving food and drinks to the gods, which was very similar to the cupbearer's daily job. Furthermore, to the best of my knowledge, the cupbearer brought the sacrifices and dedications directly to their supposed final destination. I am not aware of any testimony that he would have served as a middleman between palace and temple only. And this has important consequences for an understanding of religious practice at temples in the third millennium. The high percentage of dedications of objects by persons from non-ruling families during the early Bronze Age has long been noted. In analogy to the example of the cupbearer who acted for his master, I argue that people could similarly present their offerings of foodstuffs in the temples. It is important in this regard to remember that the sacrifices brought by the cupbearer were always extra donations, which were added to the regular presentation of foodstuffs from the temple's own funds. These additional deliveries were recorded in the documents of the presenters' organization, the Amunus Archive, the Royal Archive of Ur-3-Pusa-Shtagan, and so on. But the complete food offerings, as they were presented, were never recorded. We do not dispose of a temple archive of the third millennium. Therefore, one would not expect the documentation of personal offerings of foodstuffs. If and how the person sacrificing some bread or beer had to be purified remains completely unknown. There is even no clear answer to the question who the nude person libating in front of the gods was. If the cupbearer was able to enter a temple and present a sacrifice, the city ruler or king could have done the same. And if the cupbearer underwent a ritual cleaning before that, why not the ruler in the same way? Be that as it was, closely related is the aspect that the precinct of a temple allowed various steps of access. Crowds of people may have filled the large courtyards of temple festivals. Here's the best preserved early dynastic temple, the one of Umayya Karib, where you see this enormous large courtyard where easily hundreds of persons could gather at the annual festivals. The consumption of the leftovers of the sacrifices may have taken place in a more closed part, perhaps in the inner courtyard, just to give an idea. The presentation of food as sacrifice may have been possible at various places within the temple, whether or not in front of a statue or symbol of a deity. In any case, it is less probable that the main and regular sacrifices were prepared directly in front of the cult statues in the inner cellar, but rather in their dining hall. At least Gudea in his Cylinders refers to this room as the place of the divine meal, but this room has still to be identified in the archaeological record. This perspective on this paper on the Sagi as a layperson, if this anachronistic expression is permitted once, helped to see the sacred delimitation of an early Bronze Age temple in a different light. Rather, as Haifa argued, there are indications that people entered a temple for their personal sacrifices and dedications. In this way, religious practice could be embedded in daily life. The closed precinct, as you see here in the temple from Umayya Karib, the closed precinct made the temple a special place, fitting for contemplation and devotion, but the existence of a precinct did not necessarily imply that it prevented the people from entering the central building complex of their city or neighborhood. The remains of dedicated objects are, however, almost the only testimony of the people's presence. It is absolutely clear that this situation did not remain the same in the Old Babylonian period, in the second millennium, and that there are more changes until the first millennium. The reduction of personal dedications may be an indicator for such changes. Another one is the new character of priestly offices, which became personal prebends. With a minute differentiation of offices and the division of time, more people could participate in the cult, but perhaps at the same time, the general access was limited. The emergence of a more specific priestly office had to go hand in hand with the elaboration of sacred space and marking its cultic purity. Thank you for your attention.
This is open to discussion.
not only. Yeah, there's everywhere the cupbearer is a person, so because of his office so close, and whether be it in the first millennium, whether be it and also the Neo-Assyrian cupbearer in Egypt, everywhere in the world, this is really a continuum everywhere. So this is, yeah, thank you. Yeah. Nathan. Yeah, that's why I've tried to give some identity.
Nicely with divine priests, for example, yeah. But I especially appreciate the difficulties with this over time, and you also described that, in fact, it changes a little bit over time with these people doing. Yeah. And I would like to ask you to kind of unpack that a little bit more, because what I understood from your different issues that a professional acting as an intermediary between the human and divine sphere. Now, I guess what I'm wondering about here is particularly the profession or a professional, right? Does the priesthood or the term priest as used in your record, does it reflect a particular status? Does it reflect a particular profession? And when does it become a permanent?
It's very easy to answer for the third millennium, and I also only answer for the third millennium, because for me it was such a surprise how the outcome of this talk to come to questions that I have always thought about but never found a way to discuss them. And also I have felt the differences between the millennia, and now I'm absolutely sure that they are as profound as I think they are. Now, for the third millennium, we have these large communal organizations, and in these common, meaning that hundreds of persons collaborate, and there's a lot of input to keep the social interaction of these persons. So what we know of the wisdom literature, of the little that is preserved in the third millennium, all deals with the relationships between your peers. And so they live in their small houses, then they go to their job. In this context, persons are defined more often by their profession than by their personal name, even, or by their father's name. So family relationship does not play a role. So for the third millennium, it's absolutely fitting place to call it a profession here. And so this is the background that at that time the profession identified the place of a person in a society to a high degree. And the profession does not mean anything about status, because the same profession could be exerted by persons at different levels, those having a sustenance land, those living on allocations of barley every month, and so on. So this is not so. And there the guru appears as a profession in the service of gods, but in the same category of the professional identifications. Therefore, I have chosen the term profession. Thank you for the question.
The more I hear about this text, from the literary text point of view, just a comment, I'm sure you know this. It's interesting to see you were looking for a sagi being kind of a connected person between the temple and the palace and the temple. And the dream of Sargon, that's exactly what he does.
Yeah.
He goes with to this to the Ezekiel, and that it should have led to his death, of course. Something happens there.
Yeah.
Also, if I remember correctly, this is, I think he.
Pashish is now known that it's a loan from Sumerian. Yeah. Pashish, the one, the close friend, the intimate.
So it's not, you don't take it as the...
No, it has nothing to do with the anointing.
Right.
No. This was cleared by Chris Pine some years ago, but it's little note because it's on a note on pre-Sargonic Sumerian. And there it's a loan from Sumerian Pashish, the one who's very intimate friend or so. Like a brother, family brother. You don't agree, it's okay. But I will take the opportunity to refer to that because it's little known.
You probably have a long
there are these family connections, of course, always. But the point is that the cupbearer as a profession, as every profession, works at the top level as at the lowest level as well. So the cupbearer, this is why it's not possible, and it's never possible for these texts to ascribe a status to a profession. The status is different. But the persons that we know, we always have these family traditions. I think I've checked them. I don't know if there's any possible for the pre-Sargonic texts, because they never give their father's names. We only see the identity of the persons. Well, generally, I have the impression that it's not yet the time for this enormous purification, sanctification, delimitation of the sacred space. So, and one has it in every instance that the third millennium is not so, has not such a role of the temple, of the precinct, of the priest as a cultural group. And so it's not a surprise that also the clothes are the same. So these clothes that we have received, and it's good to note that these clothes are woolen like the other ones, although at the court of Ebla at the same time, or a little bit earlier, there are special linen clothes for cultic performances of the ruler. So there exists a differentiation, but here it's apparently not the case. Concerning the food and drinks, it's the drink, the standard drink in Mesopotamia is beer, because this you can produce from the grain that one has, and there's no other drink that is used. And it's used for drinking and for offering as well. There are libations of water, and I would like to take this as a comparison with the hand washing. The hand washing is very often forgotten in the presentation, that's why I've underlined it, and it's an essential part of a meal. The food that we know from the lists of sacrifices are the same food that are used for banquets. There's absolutely no difference, and I had hoped to find a difference in the sets of vessels and recipients, and there's also no difference between the banquets and the in the terminology, except the tiny bowls that were set in front of the or where the offering was placed. There's a difference because these tiny bowls are only in the lists of texts for sacrifices, but not for banquets. So the materiality is a very good aspect to underline it. Thank you.
There was one question.
Is Sagi alone from Akkadian?
I don't know. And even if the reading Sagi is correct, is disputed, but it's everybody knows what we are talking about. And as far as I know, there's no evidence to prove that for the early period, and there's no evidence to be a counterexample. So I just leave it like that.
Okay, Dan, then one question over there. Please short, because we.
Yeah, it's nice with these many cupbearers at the court of the prince, of the lady. So she is the ruling lady. She has something like 6 or 8 cupbearers around her. What do they do all the time? The one is caring for the drinks, the one for the eat, one for the oil, I don't know. And what is nice, although the time frame is very small, it's only 15 years, there's a change of office in between. And there are very few persons in this close circle of persons that go from the first Queen Parinamtara to the second one, Sasa. Most of the court personnel is exchanged. With the cupbearers, there remains one, and also with the other ones, and one can assume that he keeps the tradition of the office, whereas the other personnel ones that are exchanged. As far as we know I always have the question of the people working in the palace, where do they live? And I would think that they go there to their work as other persons in the third millennium go to their large storerooms or craftsman ateliers as they work. And of course, you know that my idea how such an early dynastic city was formed was very much influenced by the example of Tel Beida with a palace and these enormous large areas of monumental buildings where economic activities was. And then we know that there are all these crafts, but they lived in their private house, so-called private houses, and then went there to do their job. And I can imagine the same with those of the cupbearers, but I have no proof and I have no evidence for that. Yeah.
Okay, final, very short question.
Very short, as I told you, I would say I've learned much and thank you very much. I understand much better now the role of the cupbearer in Hittite festival bands and in our context. And in fact, you underestimate, in my opinion, the situation of their beginning, because I see many similarities. In fact, this cover of our text is very similar. And I understand much better now what I have in my text from what you said. That means he appears mostly with a king or his representative, or the crown prince, but not only, as part of the state cult in festivals celebrated in different centers of the Hittite state. And a part of that, of this cover connected with the king or the court, I would say, this is, we don't know how many covers could have been at the court, but this was, I think, the main one. But we have also such a category called covers of the temple. So maybe this is what you said, that these covers in your sources are connected somehow with extra offerings. And it would be very interesting how far they are connected to the state cult in Hittite reality, and how far also we have cupbearers of the temple. They are called cupbearers of the nation. Maybe they are connected already with the proper cult. So thank you very much. I cannot speak a lot.
Thank you for your kind words. I almost fly back to my seat.